of thanksgiving with very grateful hearts for the great God that we have, who has given us some very important things to know and believe. During the month of November, we have been saying together the Apostles' Creed, which is a great summary of our faith. So let me ask you to stand now as we state together the things we believe as expressed so well in the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again, and He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we gather as the communion of the saints, so very, very blessed by you, so very, very grateful for your blessings to us day by day. May we offer up to you, Lord, the very highest of our worship and praise. For this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let's remain standing and say how thankful we are as a people.
Good morning, Mark.
Good morning.
Be seen number 637. Come, be thankful, people. Come, all verses.
Oh.
Thanksgiving is one of my favorite holidays for sure. And we ought to make the most of it. Welcome. Welcome to Stockton Memorial Baptist Church. It's Thanksgiving service, Sunday before Thanksgiving Day, which we'll gather and celebrate in good ways this coming Thursday. Of course, it's a very happy Thanksgiving for you. Today, if you can, right after the worship service, please linger so we can have a brief business meeting session. And just, if you can, linger for that a little while. We would appreciate that very, very much. And the Women's Bible Study is coming up this Tuesday, and that's at noon. Everybody's welcome. Ladies are welcome to be part of that. And you know, we've been having Wednesday night dinners and Bible studies, but we will not have one this Wednesday night, so don't come, okay? We're not having one. Wait till the next week. And I hope that you are taking note of all the good things in your bulletin today, going on in the life of the church, and on the back page, the different mission opportunities we have. Stockton's Christmas wish tree is still available there. Are some tags still left on there? Some of you may have picked some up this morning, and you see how to respond to those coming up and bringing some gifts. Number two, you can't ignore, because I was informed that that need has been taken care of, will be taken care of, which is very, very nice. But maybe number three, if you got a car laying around you don't need anymore, perhaps you would like to donate that in the way indicated. That's a nice thing. And of course, then something really, really important to the social event of the year is coming up this afternoon. Hey, you're invited. Stop by our house, please, if you would. You got the address there. We live on Hunter Street Drive. Only about 8 miles from here. We would love to see you, have you in our home, visit together. I've been busy baking cookies and you don't believe that. Debbie's been busy doing that. I've been cleaning up the yard and doing whatever else she tells me to do. You know how that goes. Listen, when you come to our house, come on up the driveway. You may not be able to see it, but there's a lot of parking available toward the back of our house around the garage. So not really anywhere good to park on the street. Come on up the driveway, okay? Love to see you this afternoon. Please come. Now, it's Thanksgiving, and that's something that we ought to be really thoughtful about. We have a lot of reasons to be thankful. There's a lot of thoughts that go along with Thanksgiving, and we're going to just see that now in a little video that brings us Thanksgiving inspiration. Thank you.
And I'm not kidding, families. Keep them in your prayers. We can't get any better than feeling bad. So, I'll pray for Kenny and share God's word with you today. It comes from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 7 through 18. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks and streams and deep springs gushing out into the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey, a land where bread will not be scarce, and you will lack nothing, a land where the rocks are iron, and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, and his decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large, and our silver and gold increase, and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land, with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and to so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your ancestors, as it is today. May God bless the reading of his word.
And may we bow before our Heavenly Father in a time of prayer, and may we do it with very grateful hearts. Let us pray. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. May it be, Lord, that your name is magnified in our worship this morning, that you loom large in our awareness, our sensitivity, our perception of reality. May it be that you define for us just what life is, where it has come from, and where it is going. For you are the all-sufficient God we know. And we do enter this season of Thanksgiving with very grateful hearts, and were we to try to enumerate and tabulate all of our blessings, we would be here all day, into tomorrow, and fill the week ahead, because you certainly have blessed us far beyond our ability even to understand it. Just as you spoke to the children of Israel in the desert in their wanderings so long ago, so you're going to speak to us today. And it's good that we can look back to the past, our own personal lives, and we can see the many ways that you have helped us, provided for us, guided us, directed us. And we can only be thankful, for you are the one who moves first, the one who gives first, the one who provides, the one who leads us where we need to go. So we thank you, Lord, that we will be able to gather together with family and friends this week. And we pray, Lord, that our thoughts then might not just be on this world, on our earthly possessions, but on the great, loving God that you are, who has provided all things. We thank you, Lord, that we can know this. We know who we are. We know who we belong to. We know who to thank. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
You don't stand your name. We'll sing number 638. Now thank we all our God.
today that your heart is filled with joy and thanksgiving. And that carries through not only today, but through this week, but also for the days to come. Will you pray with me, please? Father God, we thank you so much for all the blessings you give us. Help us, Father, to understand that those blessings are meant to be shared out into the world and not to be hoarded. We thank you again for how richly you bless us. And as we give a portion of those blessings back to you, we just ask that you will receive them, the hearts that they're given, full, loving, and giving hearts, and that you will take those contributions, Father, and just let them magnify to your glory. For it's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.
For every sin.
Jesus.
Aren't you?
Amen.
Thank you, guys. During this season of Thanksgiving, we note that different people are thankful for different things. For instance, there was this mom who was outside one morning shoveling the snow off of her driveway. And she stopped to wave to a neighbor who came outside. And the neighbor asked, "How come your husband's not out here shoveling the driveway off?" And she explained that one of them had to stay inside to take care of their young children. And he said, "Oh, I'm sorry about your bad luck." And she said, "Don't be sorry, I won." When you've got small children, you understand that kind of gratitude perspective, don't you? I hope you're ready for Thanksgiving, and not just for the turkey and all the feasting. We're here today to prepare our heads and our hearts to have real gratitude. Real gratitude. Because giving thanks is very important to having a successful life. There's a growing body of research that indicates that a sense of gratitude is very vital if anybody is going to be happy, if anybody is going to feel like they have a whole life. It's got to be built on gratitude. Of course, for some people, Thanksgiving is all about football. Irma Bonnebeck, remember her? She was a humor columnist, wrote a lot of different things. One time, Irma Bonnebeck wrote, "Thanksgiving dinners take 18 hours to prepare. They are consumed in 12 minutes. Then she added, "Half times take 12 minutes. This is not a coincidence." When she wrote that, that was true. For the NFL, the length of the halftime games were officially 12 minutes. But of course, now they had to add all these commercials for you to watch the mile of their products, and it's a lot longer than 12 minutes. And on special occasions like the Super Bowl, that kind of thing, oh my goodness, halftime lasts what, an hour? Because they got to sell you all this stuff. But if football is your thing, then you have something to do on Thanksgiving Day besides eat. You can watch football. Now, the Bible passage that we have before us this morning is a classic one. It just fits Thanksgiving celebrations to a T. Because Moses is addressing the children of Israel between the time that they had exited from Egypt, traveling through the wilderness, and they had not yet entered the promised land. Moses has a warning to give them as they are about to do that. And what he told them is just fitting. And it applies to us today, even though it's 3,000 years later. What he was saying fits us today. Moses told them that God was bringing them to a land that was rich in natural resources. He got specific. He said, "There'll be brooks and streams, deep springs gushing out into the valleys and the hills." Well, they really needed that kind of stuff for their farming society that they had. They had to raise their crops. A land with wheat, barley, vines, and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey. A land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing. A land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. You know, we live in that kind of a land. We live in North America. The United States, from one sea to the other, has an abundance of natural resources. This describes our land to a T. We are a rich nation in many, many ways. One of the big reasons is because of our economic system. Let me ask you a question. How many shoes do you own? How many pairs of shoes are in your closet? You probably say, I don't know. About 30 years ago, I was reading about a Russian and an American who were talking about the differences in their countries. And the Russian asked the American, "How many pair of shoes do you have in your closet?" And like you, the American said, "I don't know, because he had so many." But the Russian said, "Hey, A Russian knows how many shoes he has in his closet, because it, at best, is two. It's two. About that same time, I also read about a Soviet military pilot who flew his big jet into the United States and defected from the Soviet Union. He was extensively debriefed and okayed by the military. This guy was not a spy. He was just wanting to get out of Russia and the Soviet Union. And so after a time, they're showing this big pilot around the naval facilities and around the aircraft carriers and so forth, looking out on Navy vessels. And he was just blown away by all of the food that the American sailors had to eat. And it was free. In the Russian Navy, they had to buy their own food, and it wasn't very good. He had all sorts of questions for them. And one time when he was talking to a bunch of naval officers, he asked them the question, "Who instructs the enlisted men how to vote?" And they laughed. They just laughed. And he said their laughter was sincere. He went on to make the observation. He said, "If all the other men, fighter pilots and all the other Russian sailors could see what life is like here, they would all defect." We had it good. We had it really, really good. I've long felt that it's like the 2 or 3 billion poor, really, really poor people in this world, if they could see what you have, the blessings that you and I have, they would think that we live in heaven. It would be heaven for them. And we should be grateful. Now here's Moses' warning. It applies to us too. "When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws and decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, when you have your herds and flocks grow large, and your silver and gold increase, and you have, and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery." He's warning them. When you have nice houses, plenty to eat, nice clothes to wear, beautiful cars in the driveway, HD TVs in every room in the house, smartphones and laptops, and not enough space to store all your stuff, so you have to go out and rent a place to put all your stuff, then you might grow proud. And you might think to yourself, "Well, I've done this. I've accomplished this." Moses says, it's not so. It's not so. Yeah, you may have worked hard for what you have, but the bottom line is all of our blessings come from God. What his warning was about the dangers of affluence. It's a danger. The danger of affluence. There had been developed a thing called the entitlement scale, kind of measuring what you've got, what's just been given to you. And according to the entitlement scale, measuring our advantages against the rest of the world, it determines that just being born in this prosperous, free land that we live in gives you 50 points, 50 out of 100. And having two parents who love you is worth 20 points. And having a good education, which often depends on what community you live in, is worth another 10 points. And being born with a sound mind and body is worth another 10 points. And having a bit of luck is worth another 5 points. That all adds up to 95 out of 100. Now, how can we know that and then say, "Well, I did this. I created this. I worked for all of this"? It just isn't so. The church I served, Mount Hermon, at one point had a lady who was our music director, choir director, Her name was Pei Ling. She was from China. She moved to the United States from China after she was an adult. And I joked with Pei Ling one time, and I said, I sure am glad I wasn't born in China, because I don't know how to speak Chinese. And she laughed. And then she got real serious, and she said, you should be very glad that you weren't born in China. And I knew what she meant. I knew what she meant. We have no idea how good we have it here. But the fact is that our rich, affluent, comfortable lifestyles just make it too easy for us to drift into passive indifference about God. And that's the situation of our society at large today. So many people, they're not at church today. They're not thinking about God today. This is not the Lord's day for them, because they have it so good. We're all so comfortable. Life is so easy. What do you need God for if it's that easy? But this is Moses' warning. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commandments. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when was the last time you were hungry? Probably, maybe never. When you build fine houses and settle down to watch football, and when your herds and flocks and you have all your silver and gold and your 401ks are just really, really good and strong, and all that you have is multiplied, you know, don't say in your heart, don't become proud. Otherwise, you're going to forget the Lord your God. Hey, this is us in the year 2023. It is. Many observers and studies have indicated that being affluent doesn't necessarily buy happiness. It doesn't necessarily make you grateful. Moses knew it, and he was trying to make his people wise about this sort of thing. We might easily assume that having a lot of wealth is going to make us happy and grateful, and yet it doesn't. All it does many times is make us feel entitled and make us crave more. That's the point made by a writer by the name of Bob Russell. He wrote a book, Jesus, Lord of Your Personality. And here's what he writes. Have you had a taste of the best this world has to offer? You went to Hawaii once on vacation. Now it's harder for you to enjoy the state park. You've eaten a steak at Ruth Chris, so it's harder to be thankful for a meal at Ponderosa. You've driven the Jaguar, so now you can't be content with your used Chevrolet. You've cheered your national champion team, and now it's difficult to be grateful when your team just has a good season but doesn't take home the title. Generally speaking, the more we have, the less grateful we are. It should be the opposite. The more we have, the more thankful we should be. But it usually doesn't work that way, does it? It is a rare person who, when his cup frequently runs over, can give thanks to God instead of complaining about the limited size of his mug. Is that true? It's true. There's that old expression, money can't buy
happiness.
What was that? Money can't buy
happiness.
That's right. That's right. Often, it's the person who has something taken away, who is missing something. That's when the person really appreciates. That's true, isn't it, for you and me? Kent Crockett wrote a book he entitled, I Once Was Blind, But Now I Squint. And he tells about his father, who had undergone radiation treatments for throat cancer. And he said his father went through a time where the treatments caused his sense of taste to go away completely. And the doctors told him, he said, that might last at least a year, and your taste might not come back at all. Well, Craig says that his dad, for the longest time, for months on end, eating was just miserable. Couldn't taste anything. It just didn't feel like eating. There was no pleasure in it whatsoever. It was something they just did, grinding away over flavorless food for a whole year. And then, one evening, he sat down to dinner. He forced the fork into his mouth, and he realized his taste was back. And Kent says what everybody else would have considered a very bland meal, his father thought was just fantastic. It tasted so good. He missed his sense of taste so much. How thankful he was that it was back, and he never took it for granted again. Every time he ate, he was grateful for his sense of taste. I ask you, be honest, this morning, at any time this morning, were you grateful for the electricity in your house? You didn't even think about it, did you? But when Hurricane Isabel came through here and probably knocked out your power for what, 8 days? Man, you missed it, didn't you? And when the power came back on, what'd you feel? Thankful! Grateful! Praise the Lord, the power's back on. But today you didn't even think about it, because it's just kind of always been there. That's just the way we are. Just the way we are. Sir John Templeton was a billionaire investor, and he was once asked, what is the secret of wealth? And without hesitation, Templeton said, gratitude. Gratitude. He went on to say, if you're not grateful, you're not rich, no matter how much you have. That bears repeating. If you're not grateful, you're not rich, no matter how much you have. So we ought to have this gratitude perspective. You're familiar with the story of Robinson Crusoe, who was stranded on an island in the ocean. Well, he was wrecked on this lonely island. He drew up two columns, which he called the evil and the good. And he was stuck on a desolate island, but he was still alive. He wasn't drowned like his crewmates. He had no clothes, but he was in a hot climate where he really didn't need clothes. He was apart from human society, but he was not starving. He was without any means of defense, but he saw no wild beasts. He had no one with whom he could speak, but God had sent the ship so near the shore that he could go and get all the things necessary for his basic wants. He had a gratitude perspective, did he not? He could be grateful, even though he's stranded on an island. And actually, he was just doing what that old gospel tune we sing, count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. That's a great song, isn't it? And when we do that, that's the source of lasting happiness. Be able to count your blessings and see what I have done? No. See what God has done. So the words that Moses spoke 3,000 years ago to the Israelites applies to you and me today in America in 2023. It really does. Affluence doesn't make us grateful. It's sometimes people who've lost everything who are the most grateful. Have you seen news reports when people come through those wildfires? They're standing there over a bunch of ashes and looking at where their house used to be, and they say, it's all gone. I've lost everything. But I'm alive. My family's alive. And boy, are we grateful. We are grateful. Moses summarizes it. Remember the Lord your God, for it is He who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms His covenant, which He swore to your ancestors, as it is today. The poet Rudyard Kipling kind of encapsulated this in part of a poem that he wrote called Recessional. And there's one little phrase where he says, Lord God of hosts, be with us yet, lest we forget. Lest we forget. That's the message that we need to take with us. When we go to our nice homes, when we have all our wonderful families or friends that we're feasting with on Thanksgiving, we ought to just say, Lord God of hosts, be with us yet, lest we forget. Lest we forget. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, may you find us not being a forgetful people, but a grateful people. May this perspective linger with us through this week and into all of the rest of this year and the year to come. For every day that we rise, O Lord, we have great reasons to give you thanks. And as always, in Jesus' name, amen.
Y'all can stand as you're able to sing, give thanks, and sing the lyrics here.
God bless.